God is doing for you.
Well, thank you. It is truly an opportunity to speak to you tonight. I want to ask you a question. How long has it been since you have acted redemptively towards somebody? How long has it been since you've acted redemptively towards someone? Redemption is a powerful word. Defined as saving something or somebody from a dilapidated or a corrupted state and restoring them back to yourself. I want to talk for just a few minutes tonight about my personal testimony and how God led me here to Hopetown. And I want to talk and show how that relates to redemption. In 2003, I graduated from high school, from God's Bible School in high school, as it was then known as Baldur's Gate Christian Academy now. And I decided that I felt like God had called me into ministry. I felt like God had called me to work with people. I wasn't really sure how or where or when. And so I decided to enroll in college that year. I enrolled in college and just began to take classes, began to do what normal college students do. And although God's Bible School in college is a wonderful school with wonderful professors and a great academic program, I didn't really fit. And I started to walk away from God a little bit and was starting to do my own thing. That's probably why I didn't fit so well. And I decided that I was just going to leave, and I quit school, and I ended up getting a job there in Cincinnati. I had a good career and was set out at an early age to begin to make a lot of money. And I don't know what it is about 75, Highway 75. Pastor Loper said God talked to him on Highway 75, correct? Just about, probably about 30 miles south of there, down closer into the city, God talked to me. I remember where I was at on Highway 75 when God talked to me. I was headed home from work, headed to my second home and then to my second job of the day, and God came up beside me in the car there, and he said, "You know what? You're making a lot of money, aren't you? You're having a good time, aren't you? I'm going to tell you right now, you'll never be happy. You'll never be happy doing this, and you know it, and I know it. You'll never be happy until you're serving me the way I've called you to serve me, and that's to work with people." And right about that time, through a different set of circumstances, I met up with, I got a call from Ricky Bourne, and met up with him, and he said, "Why don't you come down and visit Hopetown?" So I came down, and I visited Hopetown, and long story short, I loved it here. The church was wonderful, the students were wonderful, the professors were wonderful, and it was a perfect fit. So I decided this is where I wanted to come to school. I wrote the school and the academic, the administration looked over my file and they said, "Yeah, you can come to school here." So I came, I enrolled, and the Lord began to really help me. He really began to move in my life, really began to direct, really began to lead me and guide me. And I seemed to grow, it seemed to work, it seemed to fit. But just like any young person, just like anybody, sometimes we fail. We make spiritual mistakes. I begin to make some spiritual mistakes. And when people would ask me, "How are you doing?" instead of saying, "Well, I made a mistake here and help me pray," I would say, "Oh, I'm doing okay." And it was sort of a mask that I put on. And pretty soon those spiritual mistakes became just habits that I was doing. And people would say, "Well, you know, how are you doing?" Instead of saying, "Listen, I made mistakes and I made deliberate choices. Now those choices turned into habits. And every time you've asked, I put on this mask." I wouldn't tell them. I'd say, "Oh, I'm doing fine. I'm doing fine." Pretty soon those habits turned into addiction. And anybody would ask me, "Say, how are you doing?" I'd say, "Oh, I'm fine." And I begin to wear that mask, and pretty soon, sometimes I'd go in my room and I'd take it off and I'd pray to the Lord, "You know, can you help me?" But the Lord said, "You know what to do. Take the mask off. Come to me." And I liked it behind that mask. I was comfortable behind that. And let me tell you, pretty soon I got so used to wearing that mask, I couldn't really tell that it was there. And through the providence of God, there came a situation around camp meeting time where that mask was removed. And the people that were around me, the people that knew about the situation, saw me for who I was. They saw me for the dirty, rotten sinner that I was. when the school found out about this, they were frustrated, and rightly so. I was involved in PR. I just signed up to travel with a quartet that summer. I had been traveling the summer before that. I was student government president. In my opinion, I was making waves, but all the whole time wearing that mask. The school was frustrated. I remember getting the call to come from my dorm room over to the Agile, and that was the longest walk I probably have ever taken in my life. I walked across the street and down Gomez and into the ad building, walked up the stairs to the office right there at the right on the top of the stairs. I walked inside and I sat down across the desk to the president, and he looked at me. And he began to share his frustration. He began to share his angst. He began to share his disappointment. And I knew exactly what was going to happen. I knew it walking over there. I knew it as I was walking up those stairs. I knew exactly what was going to happen. What was going to be the end of me. He was going to put the hammer down. He was going to say, listen, we accepted you, and we weren't sure how you were going to act. We put up with you. We allowed you to be in this college, and this is what we get at. A two-faced lie. I knew he was going to put the hammer down on me. I knew he was going to send me home. I knew that he was going to tell me never come back. Don't even bother. And I figured that this probably right here would be the end of ministry for me. I remember President said, look, he looked at me across the desk. He was frustrated. We were both crying at that point. And he said to me something to this effect. He said, he kind of stopped for a little bit, and he started shaking his head at me, and he kind of squinted his eyes, and he said, well, I don't feel like God's done with you. I'm not done with you either. Hope Town's not done with you either. So here's what we're going to do.
We were on the phone where I would go back home. I would be involved in talking with my pastor. Through the body of Christ working together, restoration could happen. And so I went home. And he told me, he said, if you'll do that, this coming semester, you can come back. I was surprised. I couldn't believe it. So I went home, and my dad told me, I got home, and my dad looked at me and said, you're frustrated right now, and you're going to be facing two decisions. Either you can get bitter at the school for letting you go and for removing you, or you can choose to get straightened out. I can take you to the place. On a February night, early March evening, I rolled out of bed, laying there crying, especially I rolled out of bed and I knelt down on my knees. I asked God to come into my heart and forgive me and to change me. And I'm telling you, just like these songs said, He came down. He came to me in a loving kindness, Jesus saved. My soul and life is to reclaim. And from the depths of sin and shame, I'm so thankful to tell you, He saved me. I committed my life that night. I said, Lord, I will serve you. I will not look back. From this point on, I will go forward for you. I have made mistakes. I have failed miserably, but I'm going in your direction no matter what. The Lord helped me from that point to this. I took some time off. I didn't come back to school right away. I actually went and got married. And for most of you who know me, that's probably the best decision outside of Christ that I ever made. God has learned in my life, and even after we were married, we were in New York, the Lord came beside me and said, look, I haven't quit calling you to do what you're called to do. Hope Town hasn't given up on you either, and I'm calling you to go back. That was pretty daunting because I left. I was gone. I was going to have to come back and face all of you, all the students, all the professors. God called me and said, if you'll go for me, I'll give you the strength to do it. And God is step by step of the way, giving me the strength to come back, to step forward in faith, and He's blessed me over and over and over again. Let me tell you something about this institution. This isn't just an organization. The typewriters and pens and pencils and computers and classrooms and books. But John Bible College is an organism of people with ambitions and callings in their life. Spirit-filled directions, reaching out to lives like mine and acting redemptively towards people and moving and working in God's direction. And I'm a product of that time. I'm a father to that tonight. Thank you so much. It's because of your prayers and support back then that the school was able to actually impact redemptively in my situation. And I'm here today because of many of you and because of the Lord working in my heart. Thank you so much.